1945, we began to acquire information which showed that there were two wars going on. And the Soviets had no desire whatsoever that the world be molded in a Western fashion.
The first war presumably being between the Allies and Germany and Japan, and the second war being?
Being world domination, global war.
By?
By the Soviet Union. Ideological.
Have you, since 1945, seen anything which altered your firm conviction that the war never ended?
There has been nothing.
For 30 years, James Angleton was one of the top men in United States intelligence. When he retired at the end of 1974, he was head of counter-espionage at the CIA. His job, he said, was to protect the Western way of life and try to discover how the Soviet Union would try to undermine it.
We're fighting a global conflict where one system is trying to change the other system. So wherever the obstacle is, executive action would come into play.
Department 13.
Department 13.
You say that the KGB use murder and assassination to achieve their ends.
From the very beginning, through all of the different transformations from the Cheka, OGPU, MVD, NKVD, KGB, KI, and whatnot, murder, executive action, what affairs, as they call it, has been a part of the institutionalized action force of the Central Committee. For example, the assassination of Tom Memboya in Kenya. To my satisfaction, that case has never been resolved. But I think it was universally accepted in Africa that Tom Memboya was perhaps one of the really great men coming forward and would have been the obvious successor to Kenyatta. He had his choice of receiving his education in the West or in Prague. He chose the West. He was executed.
Who killed him?
I said it has never been resolved.
Who do you believe killed him?
My belief is that it was executive action.
The KGB?
The KGB.
It's within the United Nations that, according to Angleton, the KGB find a veneer of diplomatic respectability.
It has been a base of Soviet espionage. It continues to be exploited by the Soviets and the bloc against the West. It's another form of the war. It's one of the battles. It's had very senior KGB people in senior positions. He was deputy chief of intelligence. He was the deputy chief of what they call the KI, at a time when the external and internal services were unified under Molotov. So we're not dealing with a diplomat. It's my firm conviction that the existence of the Department of Disinformation has had much to do with the disarray of what I would call unity in the West. I would also say it is perhaps least understood by the intelligence services and by their masters. And I speak from there, from prime ministers down, and particularly secretaries of state, because it deals with gaining the objectives short of nuclear war. And it presents to the West, by the various themes that it promulgates, what I call a wilderness of mirrors. They can have you believe whatever they desire you to believe. And if you have, as they do, control over both, not both, but all forms of communication with the West, whether it be the media, diplomats, tourists, students, culture, all playing the same theme, that becomes a very convincing conglomerate of information to a man who's attempting to do an overall evaluation. It leads the West to regard Romania as something separate from Czechoslovakia or Poland or Yugoslavia.
Misleading, you mean?
Misleading in terms where the West pours its resources, its great resources, into these various bloc countries who are unified by common ideology, working towards common objectives. And there was, in fact, a formal intelligence agreement that was perfected between the Cubans and the Soviets some time ago. And that's where, from a counterintelligence point of view, we are somewhat displeased that England has given safe haven to this person called Philip Agee.
You make it sound very easy to get the control arbitrarily in this way. I mean,
It's in that kind of system it is easy, where there is no lack of manpower, no lack of mandate, no lack of purpose, no lack of objective. In the West, it is almost inconceivable to be able to deceive when the very people who are your lawmakers are the ones who destroy your secrets. The very people who profit from living in a democratic institution are those who have denigrated the word national security until it has no meaning.
James Angleton, the hardliner, for 30 years the implacable opponent of communism, resigned from the CIA in December 1974. No one seemed to realize anymore, he said, that even an imperfect democracy was preferable to a totalitarian state.
During the change of leaderships within the agency, having served from the first director all the way through, and the successors to Mr. Helms coming aboard, it was not long before there was a dismantling or decentralization of counterintelligence. And it became quite clear that counterintelligence, which I regard to be the queen on the board, was being neglected. I would put it to you in this fashion, that during the war I saw many services whose countries were occupied and overrun, their files violated, their officials humiliated, their agents exposed, trying to bring themselves back together again. And many never did. And prior to the difficulties with CIA, it was the Swedish, the French, the Italians, and many other Western services who were being, had already been subjected to the same denigration, and much of it coming from the communist parties within those countries. So that when I had my final meetings, I was offered other positions and other compromises, and I refused.
So Angleton went. In the end, he believes, it was the breaking of President Nixon that did most damage to the CIA. For Nixon failed to win the crucial battle, that national security is above the law.
No one, prior to December 1974, would have ever conceived the debacle that occurred in the United States by what I would term an inept intelligence leadership and a very irresponsible approach by the administration. And I would suggest that this was an issue that should have been taken to the Supreme Court by the executive as a matter of being determined on constitutional basis. I believe there are inherent rights in the President of the United States to advance national security. It's inherent in his election.
There are those, of course, who would say, forgive me, there are those, of course, who would say that the CIA's wings were simply clipped, that they had been going too far, too fast, too freely.
Oh, there are those who will say anything. there is always a question whether a democratic country is capable of having an intelligence service of any great merit, simply because of the built-in inhibitions. It usually takes a national crisis or a Pearl Harbor where people then understand what survival means. But you don't have to be a great or large or wealthy country to have a good intelligence service. As long as you have the norms, as long as you have the disciplines, as long as you have the motivation, the singleness of purpose, you can be a small service, have one great penetration, and you can move the world.
Why do we need intelligence at all?
For survival. Fundamentally for survival.
Have you any regrets about going?
Under the circumstances, I have no regrets. But I regret not being in CIA.
You miss it?
Totally.
For some, James Angleton's vision of the world is uncompromising, belligerent, frightening, the view of the cold warrior. For others, his catalogue of the disarray and weakness of Western intelligence in the aftermath of Watergate will be just as alarming. For them, and for James Angleton, the only hope lies in the possibility that the end of the Kissinger era will also spell the end of détente. But that, of course, will be up to the politicians, and not the CIA.